Welcome to the course on game theory in the autumn term 2020 at the University of Mannheim. This is the fifth video of week 10. In the last video, we have seen the definition of a cooperative game. Let me go back to this definition. So it is a rather poor object. It consists just of a finite set of players, script A, players 1 to n, and a map V from the power set of A to the set of real numbers, which gives for any subset of A a real number. So the subsets are called coalitions, and then these numbers are the values of the coalitions. And this V is called coalition valuation or characteristic function. So this is a rather simple definition, but we will see that the theory around it is interesting and it has lots of applications. So now let us go back to the start of this video. Now we start with the theory. I give some additional concepts which will be useful. So here an imputation is a vector of m real numbers which satisfies the following two conditions. First, the condition of individual rationality. For any player, the value zi, so the ith coordinate of this vector z, is at least as big as the value of the one-player coalition. So the motivation here is that for any player can fall back to the one-player coalition, and he can demand that he gets at least the value of his, which he gets as a one-player coalition. So that's condition of individual rationality. On the other hand, the sum of these values of the vector z should be precisely the value of the total coalition, of the coalition which consists of all players. Somehow that is the amount which can be distributed and not more can be distributed, so exactly that will be distributed. So an imputation is a vector which satisfies both these conditions, the condition of individual rationality and the condition of collective rationality. And the set is called script Z, the set of all imputations. And this is the first coalition solution concept for cooperative games, which we get to know here. Of course, it may happen that the set is empty. If the sum of the values of all one-player coalitions is bigger than the value of the total coalition, then the set of imputations is empty. Of course, such games are not nice. We will not consider them anymore. So each player can demand to get his part, but the sum of the individual demands is bigger than the whole cake which can be distributed. It doesn't make a lot, this can't be solved. So the second case is a boundary case. If the sum of the values of the one-player coalitions is exactly equal to the value of the total coalition, then the set of imputations consists of exactly one vector, and this is the vector which gives each player the value of his one-player coalition. So this is also not nice. It's a somehow rather empty theory. We have just one possible imputation. Interesting is the third case, the case when the sum of the values of all the one-player coalitions is smaller than the value of the total coalition. Then something can be distributed. Then every player has a minimal demand, but the sum of the minimal demands is smaller than the whole cake. So then man can distribute, and then one can quarrel and one has problems. So then it's interesting. So in this case, the set of imputations is a simplex of maximal dimension. So especially it's a polytope and it's compact and convex. And we can be much more precise. We can precisely give the corners of the simplex. Namely, the simplex is a convex hull with the corners z upper 1 to z upper m, where these z upper j are defined as follows. For j from 1 to m, zj is the vector which gives to each player I not equal j the minimal amount, namely the value of the one-player coalition of the player I. And to player zj, it gives the maximal possible amount, it gives all the rest. So in because of our assumption that the sum of the values of the one-player coalition is smaller than the value of the total coalition, this part is bigger than the value of the one-player coalition of player J. Here I could just as well write j at this point. So, so in the vector that j, all players except j get the minimal amount and player j gets the maximal amount. And I claim that they form the corners of the simplex, and I claim that this simplex is exactly the set of imputations. So this has to be proved now. So and in this, maybe first in this third case, we call the game essential, and the other two cases, in that then we call the game inessential. So we will not consider inessential games anymore, we will restrict to essential games. So the proof for the first and second case is trivial, it's clear. Now I take care of the third case. First, we will see that these special vectors z upper j are in fact imputations. So there are two conditions which have to be checked. The first one is given here, and that's true by definition. So for I not equal j, zj I is equal to the one value of the one player collision v of I, and for j equal I, it's even strictly bigger. And the sum of all these values here is exactly to the value of the total collision, also by the definition of zji. So thus, therefore, the vector z upper j is in fact an imputation. Now we have to see that any imputation is a convex combination of these imputations z1 to zm. So we start with an arbitrary imputation z. Then by definition, it's an imputation. We know that the value zi is bigger or equal than the value of the one player collision with member I. So, and also we know that the sum of all these differences is bigger zero. So we have these differences here, and then we consider the sum of these differences. And yeah, that is exactly the difference of the value of the total collision minus the sum of the values of the one player collisions. And this was bigger zero by assumption because the game is assumed to be essential. So now somehow this difference here prescribes how close our imputation is to the imputation z upper I. So now I first construct a certain convex combination of z1 to zm. It is given here. So it is a linear combination of the zj, and the coefficients are such that it's a convex linear combination. It is a convex linear combination because the sum of all these entries here is equal to 1. That's exactly what I had written in this equation here. So therefore, it's a convex combination of these vectors z1 to zm. So and now I claim that this convex combination is precisely the imputation z with which we started. So it means if we can write that as a convex combination of zj, so it is in the convex hull of z1 to zm. And that means that the set of all imputations is precisely the convex hull of z1 to zm. So now I will prove that this exclamation mark here, this condition. So for that I have to check that the ith entry of this convex combination which we have seen here is precisely z upper I. And you will see that on the next slide. So you can see everything together. So the ith entry, so for j not equal, for j not equal to I, the ith entry of z j I is equal to v of I. So that gives us this first term here. For j not, for I is fixed, j is running, and for j not equal I, z upper, the ith entry of zj, so this is here then zji. And the coefficient is just the coefficient which we see here. And then for the j equal to I, we get this other coefficient, that here this, this is then zii for z equal to I. And then they again have the same coefficient here as above. So and now we can rewrite this. So I can put the V of I, I have here V of I, m minus 1 times, and one more V of I. And the sum of the coefficients, they add up precisely to 1. Because these are all these coefficients here and all this coefficient here. So they add up to 1. Therefore, I get V of I with coefficient 1 at this place. And then the rest here, then we see also this element. And this cancels with the denominator of this coefficient. So there we get precisely the difference that I minus V of I. So and now we'll erase all this mess here. So sorry. So and therefore the difference of V of I and Zi minus V of I is exactly equal to Zi. So that means that this vector which we had defined here it is precisely the vector z. So, but here I wrote that the proof ends, but it's not completely true. I missed in the manuscript to prove the second statement, namely that this is a really a simplex of dimension m minus 1. So I proved that the set of imputations is a convex hull of z1 to zm, but I missed here to prove that it is this convex hull is really a simplex of dimension m minus 1. So that for that I have to show that these vectors z1 to zm are linear independent, or that the differences to one of them give m minus 1 linear independent vectors. And for this I have prepared some few handwritten notes here. It's in addition to the proof of lemma 6.5. So I define now first a vector y, which consists just of the values of the one-player coalitions, V of 1 to V of m. Then I find a positive scalar C, which is the difference of the value of the total coalition minus the sum of the values of the one-player coalitions. And by assumption, this is positive because the game is assumed to be essential. And then we have the standard object, the vectors E upper J, which have at the place J here entry 1 and except everywhere else entry 0. This is the standard basis of R up to M. And now the definition of our vector Z upper J tells us that Z upper J here is precisely Z upper J here is precisely the sum of Y plus the positive constants times the standard vector EJ. So Y gives for any vector, any player the minimal demand. And C times EJ gives them the excess which player J can get in the vector ZJ. So, and now if we take the differences J minus Z1, then we get just this constant C times EJ minus E1. And that's now obvious that these are M minus 1 linear independent vectors. And that tells us that we really get a simplex. So the convex hull of the vector z1 to zm is really simplex, and the corners are z1 to zm. So this I had missed in the proof of this lemma 6.5. So now we can go on. Then now the next concept. An imputation x in z dominates an imputation y in z with respect to a coalition B, a subset of A which is not empty, if the following holds, two conditions. The first is very natural, the second has to be discussed. So the first is that for any player I in this given coalition, Xi is bigger than Yi. So this is a condition of preference. So for the players in the coalition B, the imputation X is better than the imputation Y. X dominates Y. The second condition is a bit more strange. It's somehow a modesty condition, I would say, or a reasonability condition. Condition of effectivity, it's called. So the sum of the values xi for I in the given coalition may not exceed the value of this coalition. So the better imputation for the collision B must be modest. It's not allowed that the parts which the players xi in this imputation get is bigger than what the whole collision deserves, the value v of the collision B. So it also makes sense, but it's a bit strange. So having this notion, we have this notation x bigger than y with respect to b, and it's quite obvious that this is a transitive relation. So the relation given here is a transitive relation. So now I can generalize the definition a little bit. I can say x dominates y if there exists a collision b such that x dominates y with respect to b. This looks a bit artificial, but it also makes a lot of sense. And then we say that x dominates by x is bigger than y. Of course, this is no longer transitive, because if we have here x bigger as y bigger z, then there might be different coalitions, coalition B1 and coalition B2, and then we cannot say that x dominates z with respect to some coalition. Only if it's the same coalition, we can say x dominates z with respect to the same coalition. So, this makes sense, this notion. Here's now another one. An imputation z is in the core of the game. Core means Kern or Herz in German. I'm not sure which one, maybe Kern. So it's in the core of the game if the following holds. For any coalition B, the sum of the values that I in this imputation, I in this coalition B, is bigger or equal to the value of the coalition. So here now I have the opposite condition from before. Here, for a given coalition, the imputation Z is not modest, but the sum of the values is bigger or equal than this coalition, the value of the coalition. So this is also a natural condition. For the empty sets, it's true. We have zero on both sides. For the total sets, it's true. By definition of imputation, we have also equality. And for the one-player coalition, we have also the non-strict inequality, because that is an imputation. So that was a part of this condition of individual rationality for imputation, that I bigger or equal to the value of the one-player coalition I. So for B empty or with one element or the total set, this non-strict inequality holds anyway. But for other subsets, it's a condition. So in the core of the game is called script K, and that's the set of all the imputations which are in the core. So this set is now the second solution concept for cooperative games, which we see in this section here. So now I have a nice lemma. We start again with the cooperative game, and we suppose it's essential, so the set of imputations is not empty. Oh no, it's a bit bigger. We may be in the second or third case. At least Z should not be empty. But the interesting case is, of course, the essential case. So then part A, if X is in the core, then X is not dominated. So there is no other imputation which dominates X. And the second statement, the core is either empty or it's a polytope. So in both proofs are quite trivial. For part A, I suppose make an indirect proof. Suppose that vector y in the imputation dominates the vector x with respect to a coalition B. Then for any, we have the condition of preference. For any player I in the set B, yi is bigger than xi. And then we have the condition of effectivity, so this condition of preference here. And here for the condition of effectivity, so the value of the total coalition of the coalition B is bigger or equal than the sum of the values yi. But now because of this, now this is strictly bigger here, then the sum of the values xi for I in the coalition. And so, and then this, if this holds, if you have your strict inequality, then this sum is strictly bigger, smaller than V of B, and that tells us that this can't be in the core of the game. So this is impossible. the coefficient game just says that there's the other non-strict inequality here in the case of a core. So this is impossible. So such a vector which is dominated cannot be in the core, and the vector which is in the core cannot be dominated. That's quite trivial. The interesting point here is that under some additional assumption about the game, which is not very difficult, we have even equivalence. So then core is equivalent to X in the core is equivalent to X being not dominated. We will see this a bit later in the theorem 610 on the next page of the manuscript. So I still want to go on and give some more concepts. So there are some interesting more conditions on the way how the coalition values can be related to one another. The most restrictive and easiest but somehow least interesting condition is the following: additivity. A cooperative game is additive if for any two disjoint subsets B and C, the sum of their coalition values is equal to the coalition value of the union of these two sets. So if part A is also, can also be is equivalent here to the condition that for any B, the value of B is equal to the sum over I in B of the values of I. So my handwriting is bad, so, but yeah, that's, man can iteratively use this condition here and cut it down to the one-player coalitions. And then it says that the value of the coalition B is equal to the sum of these values of the one-player coalitions. That means in the additive case, the values of the one-player coalitions determine the whole coalition valuation. So another condition, which is weaker, there we have then strict inequality instead of equality, is the following. It is the super additivity. A cooperative game is called super additive if for any two subsets of the player set which are disjoint, the sum of the coalition values of these two subsets is less or equal to the coalition value of their union. And convexity is a third condition, which is in between additivity and superadditivity. Here we demand that for any two subsets B and C of the player set A, the sum of their coalition values is less or equal to the sum of the coalition value of the union plus the sum of the coalition value of the intersection. So, and I claim that convex is between additivity and superadditivity. It is stronger than superadditivity, because superadditivity follows. If here we have two sets which are disjoint, then in the disjoint case, then this is the empty set, and then V of the empty set is by our general definition equal to zero. So then we get here the condition in this situation. So therefore, from superadditivity follows from convexity. So now I will start to discuss these conditions. First, some very elementary properties. So in the case of a convex game, additivity is the strongest condition. Then we have convexity and superadditivity. Here, I think this I already proved just 30 seconds ago. And now I would still want to prove this, that additivity gives convexity, but this will be also easy. And part B tells us that for any player set, we can compare the sets of cooperative games with additional properties. So the set of additive games is a real subvector space of all the cooperative games. We have this natural vector space structure on the set of coalition values on the set of games with fixed player set A. And additivity is itself some additive condition. So the set of convex games contains a set of additive games because of part A. And this is no longer a subvector space, but it's a cone. So when I have to say what a cone is, it's written here. A cone is in an R vector space is a subset which is closed under addition and multiplication with non-negative scalars. So here we need non-negative scalars. So, and I claim that if you have a sum of two, if you have one convex game, then any positive multiple of it is again convex. That's rather trivial. And I claim also that the sum of two convex games is again a convex game. That's also quite clear. We just have to go, sorry. We just have to go back here. Yeah, this non-strict inequality in the convex case that is preserved under addition of convex games, under addition of these coalition valuations. And the same for the superadditive case, this non-strict inequality which you see in part B is also preserved if you add some coalition valuations. So therefore, and it's also preserved if you multiply some coalition value by some non-negative scalar. So therefore, part B is quite trivial. The set of convex games is a cone, and the set of superadditive is a cone which contains set of convex games because of part A. So the only thing which I still want to prove here is this part that additivity gives the convexity in the case of cooperative games. So it's written here. So suppose you have an additive game, then the coalition value of some coalition B is the sum of these values of the one-player coalitions in B. That of C is the sum of the values of the one-player coalitions in C. Now we can reorder these values of the one-player coalitions. We can put all the one-player coalitions in B and TC together, but then we have those in the intersection again. They turn up two times. They turn up on the left and on the right. So we have then these two sums. And again, by additivity, this is equal to the value of the union of these two coalitions plus the value of the intersection of these two coalitions. So therefore, we have here equality. And yeah, we have even equality, and this is much more than we need for convexity. For convexity, we just need a non-strict inequality. So, but especially then this cooperative game is also convex. Yes, and if the game is convex, it's written already, if the game is convex, it starts here now, the second part. If we have a convex game, then for any two subsets whose intersection is empty, the sum of their two coalition valuations is by convexity satisfies this strict non-strict inequality, and this here is equal to zero. So then we arrive here, and this tells us that this game is in super additive. So the last part which I want to now to formulate in this video is the following theorem, which is very surprising, which is a bit surprising and not so easy. Part A, the core K of a convex cooperative game is not empty. So I didn't assume that the convex game is essential, but it's automatically essential. Or maybe this boundary case. So anyway, it's not empty. And part B is the surprising thing. In the case of a super additive game, we have that X is in the core if and only if X is not dominated. So the implication from left to right, that was lemma 6-7. Now the opposite implication, that's a surprising fact that this also holds. And that is not so easy. We will give the proof, but only in section 6-3, not here. So I will stop the video now so that it doesn't become too long. So thank you very much for listening.